you.
A ballad behind bars, or you could say real rock from the rock. An unusual musical happening in a most unusual place. The state prison...
I got a letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it. It said they were suckers. They wanted me for their army or whatever. Picture me giving a damn. I said never. Here's a land that never gave a damn about a brother like me and myself, because they never did. I wasn't with it, but just that very minute it occurred to me the suckers had authority. Cold sweating as I dwell in my cell. How long has it been? They got me sitting in a state pen. I gotta get out, but that thought was thought before. I contemplated a plan on the cell floor. I'm not a fugitive on the run, but a brother like me begun to be another one. Public enemy serving time, they drew the line, y'all. They criticized me for some crime. Nevertheless, they could not understand that I'm a black man and I can never be a veteran. On the strength of situations unreal, I got a raw deal. So I'm looking for the steal.
But I know I was introduced to it in the spring of 1988. My neighbor, Joe Rockmore, had the tape, and I borrowed it from him. He went to a different high school, so I didn't see him for like 4 months. And luckily, I didn't see him for like 4 months, because I was able to really listen to that. And this album, along with... Eric B. and Rakim, Follow the Leader, is basically the two albums for me that really, like, you know, growing up, there was other hip-hop, you know, there was Run DMC and stuff like that, and you hear songs on the radio.
In time, they got me serving to those of them. I'm not a citizen, but ever when I catch the
GCI, but I think it was Thursday night, I think it was WHPK, had a radio, had a hip-hop show, I think it was a Thursday night, like at 11, the DJ's, I think it was Pink House, and he played hip-hop, but it was like this, like you had to, like your radio had to be like in a certain deal to listen to it, and it's 11 on Thursday, so it's gotta kind of be quiet so your folks wouldn't wake up, but you know, you listen to this hip-hop show, and you, like, you listen to it, it's like, oh, he's playing this random artist, who is this artist, and you write it down to figure out, does anybody at school have this dude's tape? Or it's just so important that it, like, it brought me into this world of this particular music that wasn't like, it wasn't like some different form of R&B that, like, kind of transformed from, like, what my parents listened to what, like, older cousins listened to what I'm listening to now. Like, this was totally different. My parents hated it. My friends' parents hated it. I don't know how important that was, but, you know, you're a teenager. It's cool that your parents don't like shit you're into. This was the album that's like, okay, this music belongs to me. Like, it just took over my life musically. Like, that's all I, from 88 to maybe 94, that's all I cared about music-wise. Was I just listened to hip-hop, and it's because of this record. Growing up on the South Side and going to a predominantly white high school, and like my parents, you know, we always had like these books from Ebony Publishing or Johnson Publishing about like black history. And, you know, your parents are like, hey, you need to read these. And you're just kind of, yeah, okay. But this, like, okay, Chuck D is talking about these dudes. And so Chuck D made me want to read these black history books, not my parents. Not just the lyrics, but like the music. It's like all this stuff you sort of recognize, but then like you kind of really get into it. It's like, oh, it, like all these samples are my parents' records. You know, it's so there's that, you know, and so there is a connection. Even though my parents hated hip-hop music, and even as an adult, they would say like, I thought you would grow out of it. And I'm saying, hey, no, it's like, I'll listen to this to like that. Because hip-hop wasn't big in Chicago. Everybody listened to House, which is great, but like me and my friends, we were hip-hop heads, you know. We wore starter jackets and baseball caps. there were, like, my first hip-hop show was at the International Amphitheater. It was, I think, Too Short, EPMD, and someone else. It was me and a couple of friends and a bunch of thugs. It was, but it was great.
Time to serve, decency was deserved. To understand my demands, I gave a warning.
My room was on the first floor. I came in, I didn't hear her. She came in, and it was the Ghetto Boys. And she goes, "What the fuck are you listening to?" I'm just like, people that talk like you. Like, you know, you swear, you swear. I don't even think she, like, if she really stopped and listened to what they were saying, she might have kicked me out of the house. But luckily, all she heard was swear words, and she really didn't put them together to, like, to what they were actually talking about. But she was just like, "What is wrong with you? Why are you listening to this?" I think she thought, coming in on me listening to the Ghetto Boys, I think she thought for a second that she might have failed as a parent.
Wait, and I popped her twice, right? No!
Blackstone Hour of Chaos. Just, like, from the opening line, I got a letter from the government the other day, open it, it said they were suckers. Like, if this was from the 70s, it would have been like, it said they were jive turkeys. Like, it said the government is suckers. You know, just like, that's so fucking dope. It's so hard. Even posters of them, like, all their posters were great. I used to have this poster in college of them in front of a whole, the whole name of the hotel was the White's Hotel. And, you know, this is probably some dude named Fred White, named his hotel. It's like, it's them, and it's black and white, and it was so dope. Like, that logo, like, what he's talking about. It was the stuff that was going on when your parents was my age. It was the stuff that was going on when I was a teenager. It's still going on now, you know. And you listen to it, and it still resonates. It's sad that it still resonates today. Like, as far as, like, the things they're talking about are still going on. And it's been almost 30 years. Public Enemy sort of planted a seed that made me want to teach history. Columbus, Plymouth Rock, like, just the typical history thing. Like, I was always interested in history. But not just like, oh, yeah, there's a reason why you don't know any Native American people, they're all dead. You know, it's like, history's fucked up. You know, it's horrible. History's horrible. Like, history all over the world is fucking horrible. It's depressing, but it's so important, like, to know it and, like, to really understand, like, why something happens. And, yeah, and it's because of Public Enemy that, like, I want to be a history teacher.
Death Row. What a brother.